Yeah, hello, my name is Sebastian Müller. Jean-Paul already introduced me. I am professor here at the IMS in Busan. And around 3 years ago, I was lucky enough to get some funding from the National Research Foundation here in Korea for a project I would like to introduce to you today. And actually, it's an ongoing project, so it's what I'm presenting here is at the moment just preliminary results in some way. And as you can see, it is about the Bronze Age hill forts in Istria. And the background story about is actually that my old institute in Berlin, where I studied, at the same time when I became a student there, they started research in Istria about Bronze Age hill fort, a particular Bronze Age hill fort. And I never joined them, because the payment was really bad. So I always went to other excavations to earn better money. But for some reasons, it turned out that with some colleague who also studied there, I was able to make this research now, and we are actually basing this research on the foundation our old professors were building up there. Unfortunately, as I will show you, it is not really possible to accept all of their opinions. So maybe they would like it, but I think in some cases, we had actually two professors, maybe I have to mention that. One already passed away, I think, at the beginning of this year. And the other one is a professor from Slovenia. She's also the my doctoral mother. So she was my supervisor. And she is always a little bit, you know, she is, I don't know, taking it really personal if you criticize her in some way. So I'm really happy that she's not here today in this sense. Okay, just a short overview, table of contents. So I will give a short introduction into that. I mean, I already started that. Then I will talk about Istria. Then I will introduce the sites we are researching, and talk a little bit about the general sediment structure. As I mentioned, this all will be preliminary results. From the viewpoint of Mediterranean studies, the Bronze Age is actually quite interesting and important time, because that's maybe the first time when the Mediterranean, okay, on this map it's maybe not so recognizable, but the first time when the Mediterranean somehow got more interconnected in some way. So we can see this, for example, in the distribution of Mycenaean pottery, and especially the Eastern Mediterranean became a highly interconnected world, and it started from the Middle Bronze Age, depends a little bit from which time we want to date that, maybe from 1800 BC up to 1400 BC. There are different datings, and so I, you know, just stick to this date. But it's not only the Mediterranean, because as you can see on this map, also other parts, in this case of Europe, became strongly interconnected. And of course, one of the driving forces behind it is that if you want to produce bronze, then bronze is an alloy, and you need to have at least two different components. And usually they are copper and tin. Copper is something you can find quite frequently, obviously, but the problem is tin. And usually both components do not occur at the same place. Of course, there are rare cases where you can find them both together. It's a little bit difficult to figure out where the places were or the resources were for the people in prehistoric times. So there was, if you wanted to produce this kind of metal in the end, or this alloy, you had no chance, you had to get in contact with each other. So that makes it somehow interesting and important, the Bronze Age, and that was probably one of the elements or aspects why in the eastern part of the Mediterranean we had actually the emergence of secondary civilizations. You could say, for example, the Mycenaean civilization is one of them. And the question is now, how these Eastern Mediterranean civilizations also affected other places. We know that for the Iron Age, that there was of course a very strong impact, but you know, how was it actually in the Bronze Age? That is one of the questions. Istria, a very nice peninsula in the northern part of the Adriatic Sea, the so-called Caput Adriae, and it is today it belongs to the main part to Croatia. Partly, it also belongs, very small part belongs to Italy, and also a very small part belongs to Slovenia. It is an absolute classic Mediterranean setting. We have a karst landscape here with all the challenges actually for archaeological research. I will let you know about it a little bit later. So our research display, I always show that it has actually nothing to do with the topic, but I always show because I like it so much. That's the city of Rovin, and it belonged to the Venetian Republic, and it's just a nice place. And in this area, or that's the place actually, or the area where we conduct our research. So we can connect somehow, you know, work with also with some nice time after the work. So that's the situation for the Bronze Age in Istria. As you can see, we know around 436 sites, and mapped are there 423. The specific thing about Istria is actually, it's, as I mentioned, it's a karst landscape. You have a lot of hills, and it's possible, quite easily possible, to find locations where the prehistoric settlements were located. The strange thing, however, is, so we have quite a lot of information on that, but the very strange thing is that almost no further research took place. So no excavations or something like that. So we know where the places are, but we don't know where they're actually occupied simultaneously. What is the character of these places? All open questions. So this is Istria, you know, is actually on one side, it's like a blank part on the map in some way. Okay, and my old professors, I will come very soon to that, they actually came up with the idea that these settlements were part, or that the whole settlement structure was structured in a hierarchy. We come to this very soon, as I mentioned, just to let you know which settlements I will talk about today, which we researched. Moncodonia is this place here, which was, maybe I can use the pointer, if I understand how to, okay. So this is actually the settlement that was excavated from my institute and my professors, and we chose to, you know, not to fully excavate, of course, that's impossible, but to look a little bit closer at other sites which are located directly next to the sea. So the first site is Moncodonia. It's a very big settlement. It was excavated in, like, I think 10 campaigns. So also for a settlement, big areas where unearthed in some way, just, you know, coincidentally also the trees. You have to imagine everything was here actually covered with vegetation like here, and then there was coincidentally a big fire broke out and all the trees and vegetation disappeared. I don't know how it happened, and so no one knows that, but it was a very lucky coincidence in some way. And so you can see the area is actually divided. It belongs to two different people here. They got the permission for the excavation. Here they didn't. So that's why all the excavated parts are here. It has around 12 hectares, so it's quite big. And you can see it also has the whole settlement has a kind of complex structure of different partly concentric walls. These are all these dry stone walls here. You have some reconstructions of that. Probably they somehow, these are different phases also, but the idea is that this is, for example, one entrance area here, that this entrance area that was quite complicated structure. So this is maybe a hint that the fortification was also used for other purposes, not just for like protecting the people. So today, it's actually, you know, it's a tourist place. You can go there and you can visit it. So that's why partly things are reconstructed here. That's the idea that, this were some houses. That's the first part where I and my colleagues do not really agree with our professors, because it's really difficult to figure out if this were really house floors, and here with the post holes and everything. But anyway, maybe interesting. So we also have here some, you know, some gate and some entrance. We have inside the fortification, for example, this stone cist, and that was a burial or grave. And obviously people were buried there in groups together. So it's like a, it's a collective burial. And it is somehow carrying also the fortification. So there's also some symbolic meaning behind it, of course. And my professors also thought that they can recognize here, and these two rocks, maybe the horn of consecration as we know them from Crete, from the Minoan culture. Maybe, maybe not. I'm not really sure, you know, but they were actually quite skilled and educated in the Eastern Mediterranean cultures and so, and they always hoped that they can find a connection between Istria and these Eastern Mediterranean cultures. Unfortunately, so far, you know, except for this and a few other small indicators, there are not a lot of good arguments that speak for this kind of theory. But it's a nice thing in archaeology. One more campaign, one more find can change everything. Okay, and here you see the finds from this place. So actually metal is quite rare. Yeah, this is typical Middle Bronze Age Middle Bronze Age artifacts. We have the pottery looks like this. It's not very beautiful, to be honest. It's quite coarse. And we also have here, this is for example from one of the graves. Yeah, the remains of some ornaments, some personal adornment. And for many years, my professors and other people thought that this is probably amber. So that would mean that it was imported from the Baltic Sea, probably. But I just heard this year they made another analysis and figured out it is probably not amber, it is something else. They couldn't tell me what it is, but they are quite sure it's not amber anymore. Okay, so this kind of connection to the Baltic Sea is also does not exist anymore. And one theory is that Mongodonia is actually a kind of proto-urban center. Yeah, so the beginning of a city. It's not really a city in this sense, but it's like the beginning of something. And the idea, because they made, for example, in the middle, so they couldn't excavate here a lot, but they made some magnetographic earth radar analysis, and they found here this kind of irregularities. And they also made here excavations, so they reconstructed a quite dense, a dense sequence of buildings here. So this is just like, you know, the upper part, and here, of course, the idea is also here were a lot of houses, and here were a lot of houses. So all together, they think that around 1,000 people were living in the settlement. You know, if you look here, you could say, okay, you need to be a specialist to figure out some floor plans and whatever. The point is, even if you look really, really a long time, it is difficult to recognize them, and maybe they're just not there. So here we have the whole plan. You can see all these areas is actually what was excavated. It doesn't look big maybe, but for archaeological research and settlements, it's quite a lot. So professors also came up with this kind of theory here that the settlement, we have these concentric walls here, and that the whole settlement was structured in such a way that it is reflecting also the social stratification of this society. So on top, of course, we have like, you know, Acropolis there. What is it like? A few leading individuals were living here, then in this area, the upper stratum of the society, then here the lower stratum, and maybe outside some kind of fringe groups or something like that. As you can see, you know, the the evidence for that and the arguments for this, it's quite limited. It sounds actually too good to be true in the sense. So one of the questions, of course, also, does it make sense, this kind of structure? And then they expanded their scope a little bit into the surrounding area. You can see here is Makedonia, here is Rovin. And we have a lot of other places and sites in the same area. And we have bigger settlements, as you can see here, indicated by these blue dots. And they argued that probably these big blue dots, these are central settlements which controlled particular area. And our idea was now, to look at other smaller settlements in the surrounding and to see, first of all, if they were occupied at the same time and if we can find any kind of hint that they were dependent on this settlement. Of course, that's quite difficult, but since there is no research except for Makedonia, an exceptionally well excavated place, and all the conclusions about whole Istria, about the whole Istrian Bronze Age structure is just derived from this one place. You know, even one or two or three more places somehow give us better insights, even though these are just small steps, of course. So the first one, the first site we excavated or surveyed a little bit is Monbrodo, directly at the sea. You can see these are quite flat hills, not very high. But they provide, of course, some protection to the people. Here in the satellite image, you can see there are already some kind of concentric structures, obviously. And then we were lucky that the institute in the museum, the Museum of Pula in Istria, the National Museum there, made a so-called LIDAR scan. So it's you have a 3D scanner that's flying over this area here. They make a scan, and it's possible to just to delete or eliminate all the vegetation, and then you have the structure, the basic structure, the topography of the area. And as we can see here, we have like one, two, maybe three concentric walls, and then we have some other walls here, also some radio walls. As it turned out later, is that this one belongs to the Bronze Age settlement, and the rest is just from later times. Okay, excavation took place. I have to shortly show you. So here is one of these areas we excavated, and a little bit downhill. This year, we made an excavation here, in this place. And what did we find on top? This is actually the outside wall, wall number two. And you can see it goes deep, quite deep, unexpectedly deep. We didn't think that we can find that. We have other structures here as well. We have a good profile, which is drawn here. Since we have different kind of layers, and it's also possible to connect that with different artifacts. That's always good for archaeology. So we have a chronological sequence, and we figured out that Monbrodo was obviously occupied here in this lowest layer with indeed in the Bronze Age, same age like, or the same time like Makedonia. And then in the upper time, it goes actually up to the late Iron Age, to the Roman period here, the upper layers. And you can see, so this is some of the Bronze Age material, what you can get out. It doesn't look very nice maybe, but that's enough, you know, to date and to compare and to see if there are some connections or not. So we were quite happy with that. In a later campaign, we extended, so here's actually this wall I just showed you, and then it goes here, the trench goes in this direction. And what we didn't realize first, but what turned out later, as you can see here, that we have the basis of another wall here. And so this is here, I'm drawing, this is the bedrock here, there the dark color, and these are all structures which were constructed by, in course of this kind of settlement activities. So here, this wall, as it turned out later, is obviously from the Iron Age. In this case, we don't know where it belongs to. It's a little bit later than the Bronze Age, but it's between the Bronze Age and the Iron Age. And this particular thing here, this is this wall, what we can see, which is stretching here, and which was not observable in the LIDAR scan, A lot of archaeologists really swear on this LIDAR scan and say you can see everything, we don't need to make any excavation anymore. But it shows, okay, not everything is visible through that. So this one is obviously from the Bronze Age, and our idea is that here was the Bronze Age wall, and later the people who came to, as they occupied here during the Iron Age, a little bit later, they took actually the material from here to construct this wall. And yeah, that's from this year, so in this area here. And again, we have Iron Age wall here and some other structures we don't fully understand. They could belong to the Bronze Age. We have a lot of Bronze Age material from here, but this wall definitely here, also on the edge, is from the Iron Age. So we can understand that also in the Iron Age, there was a quite massive fortification of this place. Yeah, so here I stand with some of my colleagues. This is my colleague Anya. She also studied in the same university as me, and that's one of our local colleagues, Maya. And we're discussing this place here somehow. This belongs obviously to the Bronze Age. At least that's our idea at the moment. We don't know for sure. So another place, Monvi-Somonvodo, is actually an exceptional place for many, many reasons. Another place, Monvi here is a ruin, and Monvi is here. So it's a really, really nice place to excavate. You just go from the city here, and then you just go up here. Problem is that the top of the mountain, you cannot see that here, is actually destroyed by some kind of water station. We don't have a LIDAR scan from this area as well, so it makes it really difficult to figure out if there are other structures here. There are the remains of one or two concentric walls here. But especially when you go in summer and you know it's a lot of vegetation here, it's really difficult to find it. What is maybe, so we made a trench at one part of a wall we could recognize, and this is from the inside, and the stones here are not very big, and of course also the top of the wall was didn't look really old, so partly these walls were reused in later times over and over again. But when you come from the other side, then you have these big blocks here inside. And they are quite important because as far as we can tell at the moment, these big blocks were particularly used in the Bronze Age. So our idea is now that the base of this wall was actually a Bronze Age wall. We also found Bronze Age pottery here in this trench. It also doesn't look very beautiful, so that's why I didn't put it here, but it's at least possible to recognize that also this settlement was occupied at the same time as Monvrodo and Monkodonia. And then that's the one from this year. We had again a LIDAR scan, and you can see here just one concentric wall, or the other walls are later. Not very well recognizable in the satellite image, but anyway. And here actually, as you can see, we have a plateau. It looks really flat. And indeed, if we make a trench here in the middle somewhere, yeah, here in this area, then after maybe 10, 15 centimeters, there's no sediment anymore. That's a big problem. In karst landscape, usually you just have stone and then you have some small layer of soil. The soil is usually washed away. And that's actually something you can always expect. Unfortunately, no Bronze Age layer. So we had to go also to the wall area from the other side. We could at least confirm that also Muya was occupied during the Bronze Age. We also had some little pottery pieces we can compare to the other places. And here maybe in the other picture it comes out better. So that's from the inside. So you can see here, yeah, it's here the sedimentation is a little bit more. It's maybe 30 centimeters. So this is here. This is 50 centimeters, so okay, so it makes sense. And here's the bedrock. And you can see here on top, yeah, this is a new wall. You can see the stones are completely different than these stones here. They're a little bit older. It's difficult to make an assessment actually when this wall was constructed. But you can see that the same wall or the place where the wall was constructed was used over and over again. But here, when you go to the outside, yeah, from this side, if you look here, then you see also very big blocks which formed this wall. And they obviously also belong to the Bronze Age. So again, we have a confirmation. This place was occupied during the Bronze Age. but unfortunately not so many other information. The point is, note the results of this fieldwork. If we look here at these places, and if we assume that 1,000 people were living here, and as you can see, you know, the distance is not very far, so we could walk here within one day or in a much, much shorter period, in a few hours, maybe just 1 or 2 hours to some places. And these are not the only sites here, the only Bronze Age sites. We have also other settlements here, for example, and here and here. So it was a very densely populated area. And if we just assume 1,000 people here, and I don't know, a few hundreds here and a few hundreds here, then we come actually to numbers of people which are very unusual for prehistoric times. So something, it cannot work out in some way. And what is also special for this central settlement theory, that all settlements obviously were protected by a fortification. If we have a central settlement that imposed its power on these places here, then we would maybe expect, okay, this is really big, it is heavily fortified, but all the other places maybe are just like open settlements or something like this, but this is clearly not the case, even though in a place like Muya, which is quite small, I don't have a measure here, but this is maybe just like 100 meters or so. Of course, if you imagine that it was also densely packed with houses, which was obviously not the case because we don't have the traces here. We made a lot of trenches, that's just one, yeah, a small sonda as it is called, but could here, in different places, and we couldn't find any remains of the Bronze Age occupation, and also not any post holes or whatever what could give us any hint that this place was densely populated. Probably it wasn't. So even small settlements obviously had a quite big fortification in some way, and maybe that's the point where we have to consider, was it really a fortification in the sense what we connect or what we think it is from today's perspective or not? Okay, I will come to this later. So if we, you know, look in general to history, just to show you this. So here again, we have the distribution map, and then of course with GIS software in archaeology, we use that quite a lot. All these kind of tools that are also discussed now with the digital humanities and so. You can see here that there are some clusters where there are quite a lot of settlements. I mean, you can already guess here, but since some points are overlapping, we don't know for sure. And you see here some areas have some, I don't know, they are more favored, obviously, by the people. Of course, I have to mention, we don't know if all these places were occupied at the same time. But just consider, these are settlements that were on top of the hill, and the hill also was prepared in some way, because as we can see in Muya, it's a plateau, but it's not a plateau by nature. So the people made it to a plateau and obviously also used, or probably also used, the stones for making the fortification in some way. So it's actually not that clever if you put so much effort into preparing this place just to move quickly to another. So it makes sense that people, and we see that in case of Monrodo, that also in later times people were using these places over and over again. Okay, so what is maybe the most, this is some Thyssen or Voronoi polygons. You can also figure out the size actually of I have to explain it differently. Actually, this is the smallest distance. Yeah, each of these kind of polygons gives somehow the smallest distance to the next neighbor here. And then we see the site, this particular place may be controlled. We can see here, yeah, that we have places with territory, with big territory and with smaller territory. But of course, all these so-called central settlements controlled in the sense a very small, or have a really small catchment area. So that's also a little bit suspicious. And if we look here, so-called intervisibility analysis, so if you stand here on the top of the point, you're like 160, your height is 160, and you look here in these different directions, then you can see, the line shows actually from where to where, what you can see. And we can see here that especially this area around Rovin, but also in other places, the intervisibility between these settlements was quite high. All of them were somehow connected, maybe not directly, but we could, I mean, it was contact situation from here to here to here. You can go from one point to another. And of course, we believe that if you can see each other, that you maybe were also somehow in closer contact with each other. Just an assumption, maybe, I mean, we know from today's perspective, you don't need to be a good friend if you see each other. Yeah, you can be extreme enemies. But since we have this kind of clustering here, which is not very well explainable also with the terrain, because it's not so much different here than here. So this is actually something where we stand at the beginning. We have to compare what is different here in this area and what is here. Are these two different groups in some way? Are there artifacts different? But since we just made the excavation here, there is a lot of work for the next, I don't know, 200 years or so. Nothing we can do. So what I actually know the pros and cons for this kind of settlement hierarchy theory. The positive arguments for this are that we have settlements of a different size in a comparatively limited area. So we could imagine we have a big settlement that is controlling the small settlements around, like a satellite. There are satellite settlements. We have indicators for redistribution and labor division. That's also one of the results. The professors figured out when they looked at Mongodonia, because they found some areas where a lot of storage took place. So that's the idea, you know, that they gathered all these things in the central place and then redistributed it maybe to the smaller settlements. And the social stratification, but just based on the settlement division I showed you. So the idea that on top of the hill where the more the higher people, and then it goes down also with the hierarchy. So this is actually not a very strong argument. But what speaks against that, actually? That all settlements have a kind of fortification, and they are also located all in protected positions. So if I want to control another settlement, then it's usually not a good idea to give them all the means for defending themselves in some way. And we see that in other times that the central power is trying to prevent that, and that we have more like fortified settlements on top, and then we have more open settlements around. And the arguments generally for the central settlement theory, that's actually the biggest point, is just exclusively based on one site, on Mongodonia, because they didn't excavate other sites and they didn't have a lot of information from them. My idea, so it's work in progress, you know, this is what I'm just checking now at the moment, is they always talked about a hierarchy, but of course there are also other models and ideas, and another one is the heterarchy approach, that all these settlements were somehow in connection with each other. They were not really organized in a hierarchical structure. It's more like a network, and they were supporting each other. One settlement could provide, I don't know, specialists maybe for this particular task. The other ones were giving, I don't know, they were located close to the sea, for example, so they were better specialized in catching fishes and seafood and redistributing it to the settlements more in the hinterland, maybe. So just as an idea. Okay, so the results, preliminary results. I think they are questioning more and more the concept of this hierarchical settlement system. So the focus definitely should be more on alternative interpretations. I don't believe that we have really some proto-urban settlements in this area. I don't believe that all these places were that densely occupied and that so many people lived there at the same time. We see that all the settlements were somehow interconnected with each other, so Istria itself in the Bronze Age was a really interconnected place. But it is, of course, now necessary somehow to figure out what is actually the character of these clusters. Is it, I don't know, how were these people organized, and actually what are the indicators for us to figure that out? Because conventional archaeology in this sense doesn't work well because of the small sedimentation and because of the challenges of this karst landscape for excavators, which is maybe one of the main reasons why no one really liked to make some excavation there, because the finds are not very representative. Most of them are quite ugly. You can be really unlucky, like in our case, you just go down 10 or 20 centimeters and then you come to the bedrock and cannot find anything. So this is of course not really attractive in some way, and maybe this is also one of the reasons why Istria is not that well researched in other places. But I think it makes sense and it's a good example for figuring out what happens in the Mediterranean, but also in a small, you know, in a kind of micro region, if you want. So thanks a lot for your attention.